simple song. I want you to learn it and sing along. It just says,
I will sing. I will sing. I will sing. I will sing of his goodness and his kindness and his mercy. I will sing.
It's a simple song. Everybody join up and sing.
I will sing.
I will sing.
I will sing.
I will sing.
Yes,
I will sing
of his goodness,
of his good
and his kindness,
and his kind
and his
mercy,
and his mercy.
Yeah,
I will sing.
I will sing to the glory of God.
Say on this afternoon. pray that this the message that will help you in your walk with Christ.
This is a series that the Lord has led me to share with his people. As I teach this, I've been in the ministry now 36 years. I pastored over 20 years. And one of the reasons I began to pastor, God gave me an ultimatum. We've been having healing services both in Hartford and in New York. And God spoke to me, and God said, it's time to do more than just preach, prophesy, and get people healed and bless them. I want you to establish them, disciple them. I fussed with the Lord because being an evangelist was a lot more fun, right? Just ride in, hit folks, and leave town. But the Lord said, if you don't disciple people, I'll kill those services. You won't have those. The power of God be manifested through your life. And that's where, honestly, most of us have problems, is being consistent in that walk and learning how to apply the Word of God to our everyday situation. And so I often point people to the book of James because it's a very practical. James, you know, he doesn't get caught up in a lot of theological musings and try to get in, you know, in the meaning of life. He gets into some real practical hands-on applications about how to live for God. And as a result, James is not one of the most favorite books in the Bible. It wasn't a favorite when it first came into existence. People questioned its authorship. Later on in the history of Christendom and the church and the Reformation, Martin Luther, the father of Reformation, didn't like the book of James. Today, many preachers and pastors don't like the book of James, because it's about the nuts and bolts of living a Christian life. And the nuts and bolts of living a Christian life are not always that attractive, because it means putting the flesh under subjection. It means having discipline and order and structure in your life that's dictated by the Word of God, not driven by your own lusts. It's about, you know, bridling your tongue, which makes everybody shout, right? It's about having self-control. It's about submitting to the will of God. And so, you know, in this, as I teach this, in this narcissistic, you know, self-centered world that we live in, the book of James doesn't play well with the gospel of me. And if we have leaders that allow the people and allow the times to dictate what we preach, then we want to exclude the book of James, because it's kind of tough. James doesn't, he's a no-nonsense guy. And when he talks about living the life and doing what it takes, it's not about sitting back and saying, oh, Lord, work in me. It's about, okay, you got God in you. Now there are some things you need to do. And, you know, we live in a time, narcissism wants no accountability, doesn't want any responsibility, right? We want to blame. It's always somebody else's fault. That's what the world does. And sadly, the church has become more like the world than the world becoming like the church. So this series, I've already lowered my expectation of how enthusiastic you're going to be. I've already figured that in the next couple of sessions, attendance will probably dwindle a little bit, but I really hope that you'll allow the Word of God and allow the Spirit of God to help you see the need, because really probably most of us lack consistency in living the life, or we have a battle with it, right? Some days are better than other days. Some days I feel like I've been a better witness for the Lord than other days, right? Some days I'm glad to say I'm a child of God, and then some days I'm ashamed. Well, not maybe ashamed, but boy, I shouldn't have done that. I shouldn't have said that, and I shouldn't have thought that. So we're doing this series because I want to help you be consistent. And being consistent means doing things repetitively, establishing a pattern of behavior. And unfortunately, you know, we have this concept in the church that God is going to come down and magically, mysteriously transform us. A lot of God's transformation is changing our patterns of behavior. The Bible said to depart from iniquity and seek after peace. It didn't say sit back and wait for God to take the mess from you. It said leave it alone. And don't just leave it alone, seek after the right things. Now, I came up in the Pentecostal, you know, the whole holiness, sanctified tradition, where they got half of that equation right. They worked very hard at departing from iniquity. Don't do this, don't wear that, don't go here, don't go there. But they missed the second half of the equation, and that was to seek after peace, right standing and relationship with God. And we spend all of our time not doing things. We spend all of our energy to not do things. And as a result, we didn't do the right things. We thought that not doing the wrong things meant right standing with God. That was only half the equation. I have to depart from iniquity and seek after peace. And James, in his epistle, in his letter, will tell us about how to leave junk alone and what things to do. You know, it's like with your children. You know, it's always easier to tell your children no, right? Don't do this, don't do that. But if you don't find things for them to do and things to praise them for, your negativity and always saying no will ultimately cause that child to rebel, or you'll break them. And they'll become so docile and passive that, you know, they really have no initiative in life. So when we talk about living the life, and we want to look at James, we want to talk about adopting certain behaviors that will help us leave things alone and do things that please God and help glorify God. Now, just a little historical context. This book is the only book James wrote. This James is the brother of Jesus. He's not the brother of John, James and John, who were the sons of Zebedee, the sons of... James was not one of the 12 disciples, but he became the chief apostle of the church at Jerusalem. And while he was probably a skeptic during Jesus' ministry, much is believed that after the resurrection, Jesus appeared, Paul said, Jesus appeared to James. And that's when most people believe that James was fully converted and he realized that this is not just my brother. This is not some guy that says he's a Messiah. This thing is for real. And James became the chief apostle of the church at Jerusalem. When Paul the apostle was converted on the road to Damascus, and he immediately conferred not with flesh and blood, but he began to preach the gospel to the Gentiles. For 3 years, he didn't go up to Jerusalem. He didn't confer with any of the disciples that were there. He had a visitation from the Lord, and he was called to the Gentiles. 3 years after he ministered, he finally went up to Jerusalem. James was the only one important enough for him to meet with. He said, I conferred with James. I met the brother of the Lord. Now, if you stop and think about this, while Peter was the disciple to the Jews, James was the guy that held the church together at Jerusalem. And James wrote this epistle to the church. And there are some people, as I said, Martin Luther, the father of Reformation, had trouble with James, the book of James, as did some other writers, because when they got the revelation of faith and they came to understand that man was justified by grace through faith, which Paul preached and had that revelation, they thought James was against that because he was Jewish, because he was the chief apostle of the Jewish church at Jerusalem. He was a believer in the keeping of the Ten Commandments. Strange, right? Not at all. He was raised Jewish. And by the way, because, you know, we in the church today, we tend to think, oh, the Ten Commandments aren't for us. They are for us. The Ten Commandments, they don't save us,